This is an account of the 1978 expedition to climb Darban Zom, a 23,665-foot peak in the Hindu Kush. The ascent was made via the North Ridge, seen in the skyline of the picture. It is more than a story of high mountain ascent. A serious fall at 22,000 feet threatens survival, and it is the spirit, determination, teamwork and endurance needed to get a semi-conscious climber down 9,000 foot of very difficult terrain that becomes the essence of this tale. Base camp was created lower down the glacier in the foreground, and an advanced base camp was created at the rocks under the icefall in the centre left of the picture. The icefall was climbed and a two-man tent erected as camp one in the coombe above. A further 2,000 foot up the ice face that you can see, camp two was a snow hole dug on the ridge. The words and pictures are those of the team: Steve Parr, Bob Millward, Paddy Feely and Fred Van Gemert. They were in Pakistan from the 9th of July to the 2nd of September. Following a serious accident 600 foot below the summit, it took them 7 days to lower Fred, the team doctor, to their base camp 9,000 foot down the mountain. It's an amazing achievement for the four friends, and a story well worth hearing. 3 days were spent in Islamabad with Major Sajid Hamid, the expedition liaison officer. They were making arrangements for onward travel, but the weather prevented the team from flying to Chitral as they'd intended, and they decided to make the journey by road via a place called Deer. The journey was to prove eventful. Rubble roads were reached before the first day was out, and they traversed a pass at 10,000 feet, including a section cut across an ice field. The second day brought a head-on crash with an army lorry.
Who in the night time, who by high or dear, who by common trial, who in your merry, merry month of May, who by very slow decay, and who shall I say, is called. Who in her life
slip. After Chagrin, the country became a vertical desert, and the long walk in was completed on the 21st of July, some 12 days after arrival in Pakistan. That left them 31 days to climb the peak.
And who by brave ascent, who by accident, who in solitude, who in this mirror, who by his lady's command, who by his own hand, who in mortal chains, who in
base camp was established at 13,900 feet, and the team decided to ascend the north face via an ice fall to a hanging comb at one-third height, and then by the northwest ridge to the top. An advanced base camp was set up at a large boulder under the ice fall. Steve gave an account of a day's climbing in the icefall. The climbing was very easy at this stage, but the unaccustomed rarity of the atmosphere made my head spin. I was soon reduced to counting the steps between rests and then leaning on my ice axe to allow my lungs to catch up with me. Eventually, my head cleared and I was able to look around and appreciate the view once more. It was breathtaking. Enormous ice towers loomed overhead and presented a seemingly impregnable barrier between us and the planned site of Camp 1. I voiced my fears, but Bob waved them aside as we climbed on. This was Bob's third consecutive day in this horrible place, and as we moved up the lower slopes, it was clear that he felt much more at home than I. Steve goes on, as the sun rose high in the sky, we reached the first of two fixed ropes that had already been established. As I pulled across, the chasm below gave out a great groan and an ice tower toppled and vanished in a cloud of ice particles. After this little escapade, we put the rope on and Bob led the way because he knew the position of the concealed crevasses. Soon we came to another fixed rope, which led to a very steep ice wall about 100 foot high. Up to this point, the climb had been mainly grade 2-3, and we had soloed up for about 1,000 feet. Bob proudly declared that the pitch overhead was the hardest on the route, and it was good value grade 4. It certainly looked it, and when my turn came, I was only too pleased to have a rope to pull on. We pressed on for about another half hour, and eventually reached the high point achieved by Bob and Fred the previous day. We had a quick snack and surveyed the possibilities. Immediately in front of us lay a minefield of holes in the ice, all lightly covered with a deceptive layer of soft snow. Beyond that, it was an enormous rampart of cliffs that stretched across the whole width of the glacier. It looked about 200 foot high and virtually impassable. We thought we could see our way through the defences, albeit dangerous. There were three ice pitches to climb at about grade 3, and as I stood belaying, I hardly dared to breathe in case it brought the lot down. There'd be no point in running, there was nowhere to run to. At last, Bob was able to peer over the rim, and he immediately let out a great war chant to tell me that we were there. We found a site for the tent, and by about 4 p.m, we were ready once more to run the ice gauntlet. As we careered down the fixed ropes, we weaved our way in and out of ice towers. I started to feel more at home in my surroundings. I was learning to live with the constant threat the icefall posed, and was eager to go back and get settled in at Camp 1 the next day. Camp 1 was a single two-man tent, ensuring that two people passed the night undercover at 18,000 feet in the snow basin. Above the snow basin reared the final triangular 5,000 foot face. The plan was to climb the ice head wall of the basin to gain the col on the ridge. This would be the 20,500 foot site of Camp 2, a food dump and snow cave bivouac, the place for the final assault upon the northwest ridge to the summit. Extracts from Steve's diary illustrate the effort that went into creating Camp 2. Tuesday the 1st of August. Forgot to say white rabbits this morning. I wonder what that means for the rest of the month. Slept very badly again, although last night I was careful to choose a more comfortable piece of glacier. Went off to the col with Fred at 6 a.m. and got there about noon. A real haul. I felt sick and dizzy at the snow cave and had a very bad headache when I got back to camp at about 3 p.m. Today, Bob and Paddy went down to the boulder to bring up some more food. It seemed strange without them, quiet and a bit lonely. Tonight I hope to get a bit more sleep because Fred gave me some Valium knockout drops. I took Senecot as proof against the tailwind, which the dehydrated food generates in quantity. I also took the usual anti-malarial tablet and a multivitamin pill. I'm beginning to rattle like an old pot, as well as look like one. Wednesday, the 2nd of August. Now I know I should have said white rabbits yesterday. I went to the col alone. Fred stayed behind to dry his boots, and Bob and Paddy had only just returned. About 300 foot below the col, I started to feel like death warmed up, and an hour later, when I finally reached the col, my guts were churning over desperately. It was only after their complete evacuation that life began to feel as if it was worth living. I slid most of the way down the snow slopes and stumbled into Camp 1 like a zombie. Steve continues, as we moved upwards to Camp 2 for the last time, I fell further and further behind the others. The old men were obviously acclimatizing more rapidly than I was. Every step felt as if it was the last. Not an ounce of power was left in my body, but I was determined to find the strength to get me there. In 2 hours I climbed about 500 feet. Fred waited for me. He gave me something to aim for, and this reduced the endlessness of the task before me. When I reached him, he said nothing, and I slumped at his feet. I could go no further. Gone was my chance of reaching the top. I wept with frustration and anger. Eventually, we said our farewells, and for a while I watched as he carried on upwards. I soon turned and descended to Camp 1 without looking back. As the afternoon wore on, my determination returned. I ate an evening meal of chewing gum, Mars bars and raisins, and resolved to try again the next day. Perhaps the day after I can go it alone to the summit. Tomorrow will tell. An awful lot depends on how well I go to the col. Anyway, if I make it, I can be there to welcome them all back. It seemed extremely important that I made it to Camp 2 the next day. Meanwhile, Bob, Paddy and Fred pass the night at the Col, unable to sleep. At 2:30 a.m. they set off up a 2,000-foot ice field towards the summit. Paddy continues the story. The 5th of August is a day I will remember for the rest of my life. It started off early with gearing up in the clear, cold, starry night at Camp 2. The ice field felt steep, and as we climbed slowly the sky lightened in the east, heralding the start of the new day. Soon we were soloing ice that would normally demand a rope. We carried on up a broader ridge over mixed ground and tried to climb on the ice as much as possible, but this often meant wading up to our thighs in soft snow. The ridge we'd been following brought us to the foot of the final summit rocks, and we stopped there for a rest and to discuss tactics. Everyone was feeling the effects of the altitude. We must have been over 23,000 feet, but I was worse than either Bob or Fred. I was coughing uncontrollably and had a very sore throat from gasping the cold air. I was feeling very weak and didn't relish the thought of the descent back to the Col. A glance at the summit rocks a few hundred feet above revealed a series of cracks up very slabby granite walls, and it was enough to convince me that we would be hard-pressed to reach the top before dark. The weather was set fair, and in less than 2 weeks from base camp, we were within 500 foot of the top. Since we were without bivouac gear and there was still 2 weeks climbing time remaining, we decided to descend and return better acclimatized and take the summit more easily, possibly with a bivouac above the Col. Paddy explains. Bob went in front to find the way through the mixed terrain which lay below us. I was absolutely shattered and found it a real effort to concentrate on the matter in hand and to keep climbing down as carefully as I could. I was glad to see Fred waiting for me as I approached a steeper section which led to the ice field above Camp 2. This particular part of the descent stood out as one which required extra caution. There was very hard ice in the back of the groove, hidden beneath a foot or so of loose snow. I climbed down gingerly with my axes barely making any impression on the glassy surface. Once down this section I looked around, once more able to appreciate my surroundings, and I immediately spotted Bob many hundreds of feet below. He would soon be back at camp and putting on a brew. What a lovely thought. It was then that I heard a very strange noise, a terrible, agonized, rasping noise. I'd never heard anything like it. We'd all coughed and spluttered in the past because of the lack of oxygen, but this was very different. It was a horrible choking sound. I realised that something must be troubling Fred, and then I spotted his red tartan shirt. It was only after I came round a particularly large boulder that I saw him properly. He was wedged between two rocks which formed a chimney. His left leg was dangling below him, and his right leg was wedged behind him. I tried to lift his head and shoulders to prevent him from falling any further, but he was unconscious, and I was unable to move him or get any sense out of him. I felt utterly helpless, and whilst I hung on to him as best I could, I shouted down to the others to come up and lend a hand. I waited for 3 hours until help arrived. Meanwhile, it grew steadily colder. The sun finally died and we were left up there alone in the darkness. I struggled to get Fred's mitten onto his left hand, but his fingers were clenched and frozen, and this made it impossible. All I could do was to throw the bivy tent over him and tie my rope through his rucksack straps so that I could hold them in case he slipped down further. However, I was totally unable to find a belay without leaving him, and I thought that if I left him for any time at all, there was a good chance that he'd be falling the full height of the face. I can honestly say that I have never before felt so totally useless. Somehow, Fred had tripped and somersaulted down the slope, unroped. His fall had been checked when he lodged in a narrow chimney, perhaps 80 feet below. This was where Paddy had found him. Below those rocks, nothing would have stopped him for the next 3,500 feet. Steve explains how the first stages of the rescue were put into operation. After hearing Paddy's calls for help, I started off up the ice field. Bob followed a few minutes later. It took me 3 hours to reach them. While I took Fred's weight, Paddy tied a rope around him, and then we lowered him to a small rock platform a few feet below. A brief examination confirmed that Fred was in a bad way. His left arm and left leg were twisted and contorted and looked as if they were broken. His face was swollen and bruised, and there was a lot of blood around his nose and mouth. A fractured skull, a broken jaw, internal injuries didn't bear thinking about. Thankfully, his feet were still warm inside his boots, but his hands, clenched and frozen, looked swollen and frostbitten. Try as I might, I could not get them warm or again move his fingers. I doubted whether he would survive the night. Bob arrived looking even more drawn than before, having painstakingly reclimbed the slope he descended earlier that evening. 22,000 feet up, 15 degrees below, with a bitter wind into the bargain, and a night out without food or shelter was not a pleasant prospect. The darkness hemmed us in, and the cold discouraged movement. No one was going anywhere that night.
Who in your merry, merry month of May, by very slow decay, and who shall I say, is gone?
It took all of us to get Fred into the sleeping bag and construct a rope cradle around him to prevent him slipping off into the night. We sat back after the effort and listened to the wind. No one spoke. All eyes were riveted on Fred. The silence deepened. I broke it. I think he stopped breathing. With my head close to his, I listened and waited. Nothing. I listened some more and hoped. Then it came as the wind once more screeched round the corner, a great heaving lungful of air. I looked up and smiled, the wind full in my face. Yes, I thought. He needs a lot of that tonight, and a lot of luck as well. Through the night we became accustomed to the Chain-Stokes pattern of Fred's breathing, gradually slowing down to complete stop, then suddenly restarting at great pace, only to slow down and repeat the cycle, time and time again. Without the benefit of our own sleeping bags, we took it in turns to lie beside Fred and get some shelter from the wind. At intervals, I passed sweets round, but any action was only a brief interruption in the main business of the night, as each of us sank into his own individual trance to pass the long, cold hours. At length, the sky turned gold, and then to blue, and sunrise came and went. Someone played tunes on his teeth, rattling like castanets. Still, in the shadow and none the warmer, we soon began lowering Fred, at first 50 foot free hanging down to the snow, and then with Bob as barrow boy and Paddy and myself as anchormen, we set off down the ice field. Bob continues. In the warm sun, I walked slowly backwards, dragging Fred down towards the col. Barely conscious, mostly delirious, he seemed to gain reassurance from having his head cradled on my arm. Having read that hearing was the last sense to go and the first to return with consciousness, I kept up a constant stream of warm, smiling reassurances. Now and then his eyes opened, and once he looked me square in the eye, uncomprehending, but with the blind trust of a child. His trusting gaze passed through me, turning the words of comfort to ashes on my tongue. As he lapsed into unconsciousness, I prayed and with that set aside all personal feelings for the foreseeable future. For all of us, emotions have become a luxury which could not be allowed to cloud judgment or affect our performance. The lower continued, and the midday sun completed our two-day dehydration. Eventually, we dumped our rucksacks and staggered on. A final drag across a flat stretch, and we were able to lower Fred over an edge, almost straight into the snow hole of Camp 2. The key to food and drink, and a chance to dry out Fred's clothing. We could go no further that day. Fred was scarcely any better by evening. A few spoonfuls of tea was all the nourishment he could take before choking or passing out, but it was enough to wash down a Valium tablet. Once in a dry sleeping bag and dry clothes, we hoped he would have a better night than the previous one. Paddy inherited Fred's gear, soaked and ripped in the day's lowering. He spent a more restless night than either Steve or myself, and by morning his painful chest had developed an ominous cough. Steve continues, since even fit bodies deteriorate due to altitude at over 18,000 feet, and as we were now out of food at Camp 2, there was no choice but to remove to Camp 1 as soon as possible. With Fred's continuing loss of consciousness and the gravity of his injuries, the chief and sole aim of the expedition had become his survival. This realization had brought with it a single-minded approach that resulted in good teamwork. At breakfast, Fred was unable to take much more than the previous night. After this, the process of dressing Fred and retrieving the rucksacks dumped the day before, together with generally packing up the camp, took the rest of the morning. The route to Camp 1 started off with a long descending traverse. We used Fred's weight to swing him across in a series of arcs from ice axe anchors. We didn't allow for the softening effect of the afternoon on the snow, and trying to move him was like pushing sandpaper across a billiard table. Apart from being the team doctor, he was also the heaviest. Our tugging must have placed too much strain on his bruised ribs, for he suddenly came round and in a furious temper landed Bob a left hook on the jaw, which left Bob feeling dizzy. It had also taken a lot out of Fred because he soon lost consciousness again. We carried on across the slope, once more taking no notice of Fred's dramatic protest, until eventually we reached a point from which we could continue in a straight line down the slope. This was a much less tiring operation. Quite soon, however, we were halted by a vertical ice cliff some 30 to 40 feet high. Bob immediately went down to inspect the possibilities for a vertical lower. We'd already successfully completed three vertical lowers, but the crevasse at the foot of this cliff would have to be avoided, and so Paddy went down to help Bob pull Fred clear at the bottom. Meanwhile, I prepared to make the lower. When the call came to begin operations, Fred was near the edge of the cliff and I stood back ready to take the strain round an ice axe in the snow above, a method successfully used until then. I gently let out a few feet of rope, but Fred stayed immobile. Try as I might, I could not get him to start sliding towards the edge. In our state of exhaustion, I could hardly ask the others to climb back up. I therefore descended to Fred and gave him a gentle nudge, paying out the rope round the ice axe. He slid slowly towards the cliff and over the edge. The rope suddenly ripped through my hands. The ice axe had come out. I didn't dare hold the rope any tighter, or I would have pitched down the cliff after him. For an eternity, the rope ran through my fingers. I began to wonder if he would ever stop falling. Please God, let him be alive when all this stops. It was only the second time I've really prayed in all my life. Eventually, Fred stopped. Mesmerised, I climbed down to the others, all but convinced that I had killed him. I soon saw that he'd not just fallen the height of the cliff, but had also gone 20 foot down the crevasse. My stomach suddenly felt empty and my mind confused as I climbed down the cliff. I felt like crying with shame and anger. I reached the others. Bob was already down the crevasse with Fred. Bob takes up the story. The sight of Fred falling like a stone numbed the senses. It was immediately obvious what happened, and also how lucky we were that Steve had not been caught by the flying coils of rope and followed Fred. We tensed ourselves for a jerk on our ropes to Fred, but he crashed to a halt before they came tight. Speed was vital. Once before I had seen the effect of panic on a tired climber. It had launched him on a vicious, accelerating spiral through exhaustion towards death. In Fred's state, any hint of panic would prove fatal, even if he had survived the fall. I virtually leapt down the crevasse, leaving a trail of rope for the others to safeguard me. About 25 feet down the crevasse, it narrowed to about 2 feet wide, and here I found Fred lying face up, for all the world as though in a coffin. His eyes were wide open and very much alive. A brief check on the conscious but very punch-drunk Fred, and with about 60 feet of ice overhanging our heads, immediate evacuation was chosen rather than any treatment. I lifted Fred with difficulty, and with the others pulling from above, managed to get him onto my head. Because of the twisted crevasse, friction on the ropes meant that the pull from above was not very effective. I moved up the crevasse slowly, bridging between the walls and forcing Fred upwards with my head, while Steve and Paddy heaved on the ropes. At one point, Fred stuck on the lip of a ledge. I was bridged wide on collapsing snow, screaming for the others to pull harder. Even Fred was struggling in a frenzy to gain the ledge. A wave of despair swept over me, as I realised the task was greater than my strength. But I made a last effort, an effort, I thought, beyond me. My heart felt as though it was trying to burst out of my chest. Fred slid onto the ledge, and I collapsed face down, retching in the snow. The remainder was easy, and less than 5 minutes after his fall, Fred was being examined in the open whilst I recovered. I was genuinely surprised to find no apparent damage from my efforts, but more amazed to learn of Fred's condition. His progress up the crevasse had been marked with red patches from a severe blow on the head. Inspection revealed that the blood was clotting on his balaclava, which had served as a pre-placed wound dressing. One wrist appeared badly swollen, but pulse and breathing assured us of no imminent danger. Though now the excitement was over, he had lapsed into sleep or unconsciousness again. After being airborne for 50 feet, our Flying Dutchman was living on borrowed time. The light was failing, and we still had a long way to go to the tent at Camp 1. We hurried down, negotiating another ice cliff, and eventually reached easy angled slopes as the night settled in around us once more. Exhausted, we were reduced to taking it in turns, to crawl down the slope on our knees, dragging Fred after us. After an hour or so, a halt was called. As there was only room for two, Fred and I were left with a minimum of gear, while Paddy and Steve descended to Camp 1. After staggering through a mass of crevasses in the dark, they only discovered the camp when they wandered into the privy. I spent an uncomfortable night without sleep, ever conscious of Fred out cold at my side. A small avalanche came down nearby, the last of the debris stopping about 30 yards away. My damp sleeping bag froze into a hard cocoon as I wondered how long Fred could survive without food or drink. Steve and Paddy arrived late the next day. Paddy's chest was troubling him, and with every spasm of coughing, he sat down in the snow, racked with pain. Together again, we made a sledge out of a polythene bag and started dragging Fred. As the angle of the ground lessened, the work became more tiring. We reached the glacier and had to clear stones off the ice to avoid injuring Fred's back and head. After manhandling him over countless crevasses, we eventually dumped our rucksacks and heaved him along 20 feet between rests until we reached camp. The previous few days had exacted a maximum effort from the whole team. Bob and Paddy had only had about one night's sleep in 5 days. Since before the summit attempt, Steve hardly fared much better, and Fred, of course, was in a class of his own. Now, 3 days after the accident, he had barely taken a quarter of a pint of liquid for nourishment, remaining unconscious or asleep nearly the whole time. The fourth day after the accident was a rest day. It had to be. From this time, Fred's remarkable recovery began. His wounds were carefully examined and treated. The hair was cut away from round the wounds on his head, and a head-to-toe examination for incidental damage followed. Nothing serious was found, apart from the head wounds and a battered face. His left eye was still almost closed. The inside of his mouth was cut and swollen, and his teeth had been rearranged at the front. At first, he was very ill indeed. Even when awake, he could scarcely move a muscle. His speech was limited to a moan. At all conscious times, he was spoon-fed liquids. His delirium had now become sleep, but about 22 hours a day. Towards the end of the first day at Camp 1, he managed, with help, to drink half a pint from a mug. The jubilation was fantastic. Food and drink were his key to survival. Our situation was complicated. Telephones and helicopters were weeks away. Help in the form of porters would take at least 9 days to call, and the food would run out long before then. Even then it was doubtful if porters could climb the icefall without extensive fixed ropes. Since someone had to remain with Fred, we simply did not have the manpower to do anything but cram food into him until either the food ran out or he became fit enough to descend. Since the food had nearly gone, the next day Bob and Steve descended to the boulder camp and returned with all the food. That day Fred drank 7 pints. 2 days followed entirely geared to his welfare. Enforced idleness, though, was not pleasant. Everything began to smell, as Fred was incontinent, so a makeshift laundry service was started, rinsing clothes in the streams of glacier meltwater. Every 2 hours we would watch Fred devour another meal, while the size of our 2 daily meals were halved to preserve supplies. On the 7th day after his fall, Fred's memory started to work again, and in the evening we stood him up, and with 2 of us balancing him, he walked 20 yards. He had to. The next day we were to descend the icefall. At last, the big day had come, and 8 days after the accident, we set off down the icefall. The first 2 hours were spent half lowering Fred down a gully, which bypassed several large seracs. Just 5 minutes after we left the gully, an avalanche of huge ice blocks swept down it, obliterating all signs of our passage. But after 10 hours of hard work, we reached the foot of the icefall, 1,500 foot lower. We did not make it to the large boulder that day, but the last major obstacle had been overcome. Camp was made on the ice, and the last of the food was cooked in the tent amidst a snowstorm that continued spasmodically all night. The next day dawned bright and clear, and the snow did not seriously hamper progress. Another 10-hour day brought the party to base camp, Chapati Land, as Fred called it. Everyone was exhausted and Fred was close to collapse, but the ordeal was over. Sajid was pleased to see everyone return. He had been in solitary confinement, deprived of an audience for his endless stories for the last 20 days. As he cooked the meal that night, each of the party in turn recounted the various episodes of the adventure. Sajid listened throughout in amazement and eventually pronounced judgment on what he'd heard. It is an amazing story. Fred is alive when he should be dead. For once, our tales matched his. During the days that followed, Fred made a gradual convalescence at base camp in preparation for his return to civilization. They were days filled with idle chatter, but the conversation always gravitated to one topic. Why was Fred still alive? The stories of accident and rescue were told and retold, and all of us confessed to a tangible feeling that someone was on our side. Subsequent examinations and informed medical opinion seemed to agree that Fred should not have survived. Whatever, we're all thankful for the cure. The expedition has served as a classic illustration of the risks that lightweight parties run in the high mountains. High altitude, the gravity of the injuries, and the lack of manpower and provisions were a lethal combination. Fred's life had been on a knife edge. Another day unconscious or without nourishment, we believe his body would have been beyond recovery. Set against these misfortunes was Fred's incredible toughness and spirit, our determination and care, and lots of plain hard work. The balance was tipped in our favour by the rocks which stopped Fred's first fall, the miraculous escape from the crevasse fall, the avalanche which waited until we had passed, and the continued good weather. Whether these were due to our prayers, blind chance or fate is conjecture, but we all felt that after the effort and success of reaching Camp 1, someone was on our side.
Larson on the Heaven Be Free.